I want to just kind of bring us back to last week. Last week was a really tremendous week here at Revolution Church. We had three baptisms. We had six children dedicated to the Lord. Yeah, that was a lame clap. Let's hear it. If you're gonna go in, I mean, why not? You know what I'm saying? Like, let's really do it. So, but anyway, God is definitely pushing back darkness here through our church, and I'm really excited to be a part of that. You know, he's not a God just of the ancient scriptures where he was invading people's lives then. He has really pushed through into our present. He's already working on the future, and he said he's going to build his church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. We get to be part of that, and so I'm excited about that big time. There's all kinds of different things going on in ministry and in our church. There's all kinds of stuff going on in churches all over the world, and everybody has their shtick. We use a little Jewish thing for you there. Everyone has a shtick. I got a shtick, everyone's got a shtick, right? One of the things that really gets me fired up right now is this thing. I'd like to share it with you. I've mentioned it before, but I want to bring it right out to the front so you guys can focus on it a little bit. Months ago, we started a group called Harmony, where we get together with a lot of pastors in our community from different churches across denominational lines, where we can serve the community together. The Bible says that they're going to know us by the way we love one another. And so we set out to start relationships, build relationships with the pastors here in town, start there, and hopefully that permeates down into the congregations as well. And our community can look at the body of Christ as a unified body that loves one another and serves the community together, all these different brands and stuff. Like, I haven't been a Christian but about 12 years, but I was confused going down the road seeing all these different brands, you know, like the Methodist thing and the Catholic thing and the Presbyterian thing. Like, I'm starting to figure out a little bit about it right now, but I didn't know at first I was not a Christian, and so that confused me. So I think we can fight that by showing unity in the body of Christ. We come together. So we started this group, and there's two things that have happened because of the group, and I'd like to invite you into these things. One thing that we do is every Wednesday, right here, right where they're sitting, and I sit right where Frank is sitting, and I get together with some of these guys, and every week I sit with some of the most tremendous men of God in your community, and we talk about the things that are going around in our world and how the Bible speaks to those things. And so every single week, that stuff is going to be put onto our Facebook page. And so when you see a video on there that says Harmony, Eustace Harmony Leadership speaking about this or that, I would welcome you, I'd invite you to spend that time, 30 to 45 minutes, to watch that. These are tremendous men of God that we've been blessed to be able to sit and pick their brains and hear what they have to say. These are people that have given their life to the gospel. They're in churches right around our community, right here, and we get to sit with them and talk. Now, they offer a lot of wisdom, and so I want you to check your Facebook page every week and see that video, and watch that video, and share that video. I'm not massive on Facebook. It's not the greatest place in the world, okay? There's some gain, there's some loss there, but it is an opportunity to share good things, and so I would ask you to share these things. I would love to see those videos go across everyone's computer and share them with everyone in our community so that people in our community can see that we're not divided, that we're a body of Christ that loves each other, loves the Lord Jesus, and loves our city together. So I would welcome you to do that. Now, here's the other thing that happened. Someone in our church called the other day, just really, really, you know, everyone's got a shtick, like I just said, really, really fired up about something. Now, as many of you know, I don't have cable in my house. We don't watch TV at the house. And so I don't see everything that's going on in our world. Sometimes that's good, right? But sometimes it's not so good. We don't want to turn a blind eye to everything, but we don't want to be consumed by all the evil either because it gets overwhelming. But as many of you know, there's been a lot of violence aimed, directed toward police officers across the country as of late. I don't understand exactly why, other than evil is evil. It's existed since way back. It's going to continue, and it's just happening. So police officers who uniform up every single day, really, when it comes right down to it, is to protect you and to serve you, and they're being murdered. That's going on across the country, apparently. well, like this person told me, we might not be able to change Washington, D.C. from right where we're at right now, but we can certainly do something here. And so out of that, I got a hold of the pastors in our group, and I said, you know, it's kind of last minute, but let's just do this thing. So we just like quickly threw together this event, and we put it on our Facebook page. I don't know if you saw it, but Saturday the 12th, next Saturday, the 12th at 12 noon, all of us, I would invite you all to meet me and the other pastors and the other people at all the other churches in our community. They're going to meet in the parking lot at Eustis Police Department, and we're going to join hands. We're going to spend 20, 30 minutes, and we're going to pray for them. Now, I met with the police chief the other day. He's a Sunday school teacher. He loves the Lord, and he loves that we're going to do this for him. He said his officers, you know, these officers sometimes have this false bravado. They have this tough thing they have to kind of show. They don't like to show a lot of emotion. Well, he let us in on a little secret. His guys are nervous. His guys are nervous. And so anything that we can do to help them, and I think that if we all showed up there in their parking lot and loved on them and asked God to protect them and bless them and help them, I think that would really help. So I just would love to invite you to mark it down, whether you got a smartphone or a piece of paper, whatever you got, to make a note of this event next Saturday at 12 noon right there at Eustis PD. Now, it's on the Facebook page, right? So you have this thing called share. Just think about it. Just fantasize for a moment with me. Fantasize for a moment with me. Can you imagine if all of you shared that and there was like 500 or 600 people that showed up? I'm just saying, what would it be like if we actually took this thing seriously and 500, 600, 1,000 people showed up in the parking lot? And I know some of you people in here, you're all weird. You're going to call Channel 9. And someone's going to tell them, Lena. And they're going to, did I say something? I was leaning on this thing here. That's what I meant. I'm leaning. It's leaning. So, can you imagine if, wouldn't that be cool with all the violence and nastiness that's on TV that the country could look at little old Eustis and see that the body of Christ would come together, Presbyterians and Baptists and this and all across, and just get together and join hands, one Jesus, one body, one faith, one city, just come together. Wouldn't that be awesome? So just, yeah. So just keep that picture in mind. Like, and as I continue to talk to you right now, if you even took a few minutes to pick up your phone, sorry, Grayson, and went to the Facebook page at Revolution Church and grabbed that and start to share right now, you would not offend anybody. That's what I'm saying. Like, who else is doing it? Come on. Do it. Seriously. Start to share that with all your put it on your page. Put it on your wall. Let our city know that that's where we're going to be this coming Saturday. That would be absolutely awesome. It would be incredible to see a bunch of people show up. I'd like to take a moment. I want to pray with you about a couple things, and then we're gonna grab our Bibles and tear into them. Is that cool? All right, that's cool. And if you're sharing, just share. Just keep sharing. It's all good. You're advancing the kingdom. Every time you click that button, you're advancing God's kingdom. Advance it. Father, we thank you. Thank you for letting us gather in here tonight. Thank you, Lord, for every single soul that is here. Thank you, Lord, for every person that has made a conscious and quality choice to say no to the things of this world and to say yes to you right now by coming here tonight. We're thankful, Lord, that you're here. I pray right now, Lord, that you would give us all a extremely vivid sense of your presence. Right here, right now. Every single person in here, Lord, as you know, has come in here tonight happy, sad, hurting, scared, just a wide range of emotions that are just bubbling up. It's our church, Lord, as you know. We don't hide anything. That's just who we are. And so, Father, we pray that you would minister to each and every need here. There's an itch that only you can scratch here tonight, and we thank you that you will. Lord, I also like to lift up our brother Ryan. You know the situation with him. We pray, Lord, your blessing upon him. We pray that you would invade his mind even now, wherever he sits, that you would invade his, you would get in his grill right now and let him know who you are and bring him back to you and bless his beautiful little son who comes to you for help. Awesome. Thank you, Lord, for your word. I thank you, Lord, that we don't have to make stuff up. We don't have to come up with anything creative. You've given us your perfect word that we could glance into and find life. And I thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. We're going to be in the Bible a lot tonight. It's kind of what we do around here. I want to invite you to grab a Bible. If you don't have a Bible, there's plenty of them around the sanctuary, although I think we're kind of running short. Might need to buy some more here. But there's yellow ones and there's orange ones in places all over the sanctuary. And if you'd like to grab one of those, the page numbers to some of the verses that we will be hitting tonight will be up there on the screen-ish. Kind of throw that in there because I don't want Jared to make fun of me. So grab one of those Bibles, and if you don't own a Bible, please feel free to steal the Bible that you're borrowing today. It is our gift to you. And then also, if you don't like that Bible, if you want to wait till about Christmas time, you can go to our Lost and Found, and there'll be plenty of nice black and brown leather ones, and you can scratch out the name and make it your own. There's lots of nice ones right around that time of year. So that'll be our Christmas gift to you. We've been studying through the book of Joshua. And we've been studying through the book of Joshua. Let me bring you back a little bit. Let me jog your memory. We started because we realized that Joshua and Jesus both had the same Hebrew name. It was Yeshua. And the people back here with Joshua, they're getting ready to go on this epic adventure, weren't they, to cross into the promised land. And so they needed a deliverer. And that's what Yeshua is. He's a deliverer. And they needed a deliverer. But we also realize that we have all kinds of stuff going on in our life. We're on an epic adventure as well, right? Called life. And we need a deliverer, and his name also is Yeshua. And so the ultimate quest, the ultimate question really, rather, is that who are you going to serve? Are you going to serve the world on this epic quest to get through your life? Are you going to serve the world and the culture and the standards that the TV and the magazine and the internet push down your throat all day, or will you choose to serve the Lord? And Joshua, at the very end of the book, that's the question. And he makes his choice. And I hope that's your choice. As for me and my home, my family, we will serve the Lord. Let me bring you back a little bit. Yeah, that's a good spot. Let me bring you back a little bit. Let me kind of run through the chapters real quick just to kind of get you back up to speed. Chapter 1 and 2 in Joshua. God's way of preparing Joshua and his people for this epic campaign to cross into the promised land and conquer all this land and receive all that God had promised them. Now, it's going to be a big deal, and they're going to need to have lots of courage and be strong. And God tells them, listen, you can do this because I'm going to be with you the whole time. Chapter 3, they cross over the Jordan River. Chapter 4, remember this, we talked about this last week, where God wants to celebrate. He wants his people to celebrate all that he has done. And so he has them build this memorial out of big rocks. So anyone who sees that thing in years to come will go, hey, what happened right here? We could talk about the power and the deliverance of the Lord. So that's what happens in chapter 4. Chapter 5, all the men get circumcised. Yeah, I don't want to spend a lot of time there. Amen, men? Amen, yeah? Chapter chapter 6, right? This is, chapter 6 is when they start, they're marching around Jericho, they go to the big, quote-unquote, battle. And there's really no battle because they march around the city and the Lord makes the walls collapse and the Lord makes everyone paralyzed with fear, the opponent, and so the people of Israel just go in and just crush. So all things are going pretty well there in chapter 6. Actually, 1 through 6, things are going well. We get to chapter 7, there's a war. And it should go as planned, right? Everything is win, 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 right? But they get to this people, I don't even know how you pronounce it. It's letter A and letter I. A-I? I. Maybe that's where they got oi. They lost. Maybe that's where the Jewish people got oi. Let's come up with that. That was good. Oi. So chapter 7, right? No, seriously, they go to these people, right? And they should have won easily, but we remember, if you were paying attention, they lost that somewhat easy battle because of the disobedience of the nation, which manifests itself in the person of Achan. Just that one guy, he stole the plunder from the war. Remember, he hid it underneath his tent, and so God was a little angry with his people. They lost that battle, but they took the needed steps, the necessary steps. They pronounced judgment upon Achan. They stoned him and his family, and it appeased the Lord in that moment, and they got back on track with the Lord. Chapters 8, 10, 11, and 12, fighting, 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 winning, winning, winning. And then why are they winning? Why are they winning? Is it because of their mighty horse? Is it because of their mighty chariots? Is it because of their mighty sword? No, Joshua 10:4. Joshua was winning. Why? Quote, "The Lord, the God of Israel, was fighting for his people." That's why. That's why. Now, chapters 13 through 19, if you read, and listen, you should read, every part of the Bible is good. It's good, there's information there, it's transforming for you, it's awesome. You should read 13 through 19. But let me tell you what's happening in 13 through 19. 13 through 19, they win the wars, and then what happens is they just simply are dividing up the land that they had won. There's a promise that God's made for these people, for this land, and so they're dividing up. This tribe gets this tribe gets that. There's lots of good stuff in there. This passed through it. I didn't find anything to teach you, honestly. But you should read it. You should read it. I don't usually do this, but I'm going to title the message tonight. It's right there. Praying to the God Who Could. Kind of a peculiar title, and I don't do that too often. I want you to think about what that might mean. We're going to pray to the God that could, that might, hopefully. If you notice in the list that I gave you of these chapters here in Joshua, there's one chapter that was missing, and it's chapter 9. And I want to camp out there in chapter 9 and chapter 10 tonight, and we're going to learn some things from that. Now, I'm not going to read the whole thing because it would be too time-consuming, but let me tell you what's going on in chapter 9. And there's one verse in chapter 9, and there's one verse in chapter 10 that we really want to focus on. Here's what's going on in chapter 9. God had told his people, when you get over to that place, I don't want you to intermarry, and I want you to kind of hang out with these people that are already there, because they are idol worshipers. And if you spend a whole lot of time with them, you're going to be sucked into their ways. The script, this might be your word for the night. Bad company corrupts good character. That might be for someone here tonight. I don't know what it is. But you got to watch who you're hanging out with all the time. The gospel says to go into dark places and meet them where they're at. But you don't hang out there all day and all night. You go in, you deposit, you come out. And so the people of Israel, they weren't supposed to hang out with these people too much because they would be sucked into their idol worship. And so God said, I don't want you to go hang out with them. This is going to sound rough, but this is the way it is. I want you to kill them all. Just get rid of them. Just get rid of all the problems and let's start afresh over there with you guys running the show. Okay? Well, the people in the area, they hear about these victories, that God is fighting for his people, all these crazy miracles. The Jordan River opening, that's crazy, right? It's crazy. The walls of Jericho, this fortified city, the walls just crumble because the people are yelling. That's crazy. So these people have heard about this the reputation of Almighty God, and they're freaking out. And so these people from Gibeon go to Joshua and the leaders of Israel, and they're like, listen, oh, this is what they did. They were a little deceiving. They lived close, but they lied and said, we live far. Don't kill us, we'll be your allies. So what they did is they got some old clothing, they got some old shoes, they got a sack of wine, they called them wineskins, they got old ones that were kind of cracked and leathery, and they got some old moldy bread, and they went over to Joshua and his leaders and said, hey, look at this old stuff. This was new when we started our journey, but we know what's going on over here. We don't want you to kill us, so we'd rather be your friend than have you be your foe and kill us. So they lied. They lied to Joshua. Now this is what happens. They deceived the people of Israel. The people of Israel, Joshua had been following the Lord's commands. This is what you do, and he did it. Go do this, Joshua, and he did it. Time and time again, and when they did that, there was victory. But this time, they didn't do that. See, it was a small deal. There was no one chasing after him with a sword or a spear. It was just some gentleman coming forward and saying, hey, we'd like to be your friend. So it wasn't a big deal, right? So what does it say in the scriptures? It says that Joshua and the leaders, they checked the bread. And they saw the shoes were wore out. And they saw that the clothing was dusty and the bread was moldy and the wineskins were crusty and cracked and old. So I guess it must be true. They must live far away. We can have a treaty with them. But there's one thing that it says in that chapter. I want you to read the whole chapter. But there's one thing it says, and this is where we always screw up, all of us today. But they did not consult with the Lord. That's the verse. They did not consult with the Lord. And listen, when the spears are flying and the swords are flashing, yeah, oh Lord, what should we do? But what about when it's not a big deal? What about when the gentlemen come to you and say, hey, we just want to be your friend. We're just here to be your buddy. Well, I can just handle that one on my own. And we're like that, all of us. See, they did the logical thing. They checked the bread. They checked the clothes. Wouldn't we do that? Wouldn't you, if something came up into your world, what would you do? Check with your friends. Maybe check a buddy. Ask Google. Ask Siri. How about this one? Do a pros and cons list. Anyone ever do that one? But that's not what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to consult with the Lord. He's your friend. He's your father. Jesus is your big brother. He's the one who created the heavens and the earth. He's the one who holds it all together. He knows what's going on, and he knows what's best for you. See, a lot of us, we have this favorite verse that all things work out for the good to those who love the Lord. That's great. Yeah, but there's another part, and our call to his purpose. That means if you want his ways to end up in your life, you have to do it his way. And so we have to consult with the Lord. That's why it says in Proverbs 3:5, to lean not on your own understanding, but to acknowledge the Lord in all things, and he will make straight your path. I want the straightest path. I don't want to take, you know what? For 30 plus years, I took the long path. I took the long path of pain and suffering constantly because I thought I could drink through the problem, have sex through the problem, crime through the problem, cuss through the problem. I thought I could do it all myself. I could make enough money to get through the problem. It's the long route. And God's like, no, no, no. Don't. And here's the other thing. It's not just acknowledge me. I don't even like that translation. It's one thing to acknowledge the Lord. Yeah, you're God. You made stuff. I like the version of the Bible that says, seek his will in all things. See, it's another thing it's one thing to acknowledge him. It's another thing to say, God, what should I do in this situation right here that presents itself in my life right now? What do I do? That's what he wants. He wants you to ask him, and he will guide your steps. He will make straight your path. You know, it's really weird. It's kind of weird. I can't explain any of this. Did you guys know it's going to be a big surprise to most of you I know? Did you know that Jesus prayed? Right? Did you know that? Jesus prayed. Like, I don't even understand any of that. I can't explain that to you. Why would the one who walked on water, why would the one who spoke to the water and calmed the storm, why would the one who created the water, why would he have to get away and go talk to his father? Maybe because I don't know, but maybe there was something there, huh? Maybe there's something there. Maybe there's a reason why the one who the Bible says is the creator of all things actually had to get away and go talk to his father. And if Jesus Christ had to get away to go talk to his father, why in the world don't you? Who here created heaven and earth? Raise your hand. Seriously? Put your hand down before we all get killed. Yeah. See, but Jesus Christ, he got away. He got away from everybody, and he prayed to his Father. There had to be something there, right? The book of wisdom in the Bible, the Proverbs, says twice, so it must mean something, like pay attention. It says that there's a way that seems right to man, but in the end it leads to death. And I think that Jesus kind of knew that. In his humanity, he knew that's what we would be like. We would go to try to do things on our own, just like Joshua, just try to figure stuff out without consulting the Lord. And it leads to death, everybody. That's the good news from your church tonight. If you do things on your own, it leads to death. You can't trust your heart. And we've talked about this before, but everyone in this world is told by friends and family and Facebook and magazines to follow your heart. The heart, no! The heart is not just deceitful. The Bible in Jeremiah 17:9 says that the heart is the most deceitful of all things. The heart is also wicked. And it's not just wicked, it's desperately wicked. That means extreme levels of wickedness in your heart. You can't follow your heart because it's deceitful. It will lie to you. It is wicked. We cannot do it. We cannot follow our flesh. We cannot follow ourselves because our flesh will lust for things that are not yours. Will indulge in things that are harmful to you, will explore places you do not belong, and it will wander from God who loves you. Amen. You know, the great Apostle Paul, he wrote half the New Testament. This guy had direct revelation from Almighty God. Incredible man of God, right? God used him to write half the New Testament, to plant the churches, and to appoint leaders. This is an amazing man of God, yet he admits in the Bible with his own writing that he cannot trust himself most of the time. That's crazy. You would think that would be a guy. He must know. But he says this, and this is an amazing example. I'm just going to summarize it, but I'll give you the reference. You can look it up, and I recommend you always do. Romans 7, 14 through 25. This is what he says. I'm going to summarize it. I can't do nothing right. That's what he said. I cannot do anything right. Who can help? This is what he says. Who can help me from this life filled with sin and death? Jesus Christ, and it's an exclamation point. He's the only one. He's like, I can't do anything right. This tremendous man of God can't do anything on his own. There's a way that seems right to man, but in the end it leads to death, and he knew it. So what does he do to combat this? Dare I say, consult the Lord. Let me give you this list. Romans 1, Paul's praying. 1 Corinthians 1, Paul's praying. Ephesians 1, Paul's praying. Philippians 1, Paul's praying. Colossians 1, Paul's praying. 1 Thessalonians, guess what he's doing? Praying. 2 Thessalonians 1, guess what he's doing? Not only is he's stressing the importance of praying, which is consulting with the Lord, but did you notice what chapter it's in? Before he puts the pen to the paper to tell you to do something, what's he doing? He's consulting with the Lord. That's what we're supposed to do. Constantly consulting with the Lord. Because why? He wanted his path straight. Why make it painful if you don't need to? God can save. He can suck you up out of the grave. My brother John said something last night, and I agree with him. Why do you have to be crushed before you will allow God to save you? Why won't you consult with the Lord right now? Why won't you talk to him right now? Why don't you reach up and you can look up and see his hand pulling you right now? Come on, look up. Do you see his hand? He's trying to pull you up out of the mire right now. Don't wait till it gets worse. Don't wait till you're in jail. Don't wait till you're in intensive care. Go for it right now. Reach up and grab the hand of Jesus. That's what we need to do. That's what we need to do. So we get our path straight when we consult with the Lord. But what happens if we stop consulting? See, that's all too common. What happens when we stop consulting with the Lord? And aren't you happy that we have God's Word? Who's happy we have God's Word? I love God's Word. God's Word's going to tell you exactly what happens when you stop consulting. Go to John chapter 15. Come on, we'll hear it. Let's hear it. Not your brush falling. I hear those Bibles opening. John 15, God's going to tell you exactly what happens if you stop consulting with him. I don't have to make anything up. He makes my job easy. He's got all the answers. John 15, look in verse 4. Listen, who in here wants their path straight, right? You want to go the crooked path that's long and painful? Who's been on that road long enough? I want off that Amtrak, right? Come on. So here it is right here. Here it is right here. And tell me if you've been on that Amtrak and you've been on that path that's all over the place and taken forever and painful and bumpy and filled with potholes, tell me if this rings a bell. 15:4. Remain in me and I will remain in you. Remember, we're talking about consulting with the Lord, right? Connection, prayer, talking to him. Remain in me and I will remain in you. For a branch cannot produce fruit if it is severed from the vine. And you cannot be fruitful unless you remain in me. Yes, this is Jesus talking. He said, I am the vine. So here's, I want you to use a little imagination revolution. Use your imagination. Visualize this. Jesus says, I'm the vine, and you, us, right here, we're the branches. So you're the branches on that vine right now, okay? Those who remain in me, and I in them, so if there's a connection, they will produce much fruit. So that's good, right? That's the straight path. Would you agree? Okay. How about this one? For apart from me, you can do nothing. Anyone who does not remain in me is thrown away like a useless branch and withers. Such branches are gathered into a pile to be burned. Now, there's some theology there, and you have to work on that thing on your own, but I want to just offer you this. Look at the verbiage that Jesus uses here about the branch that is apart from him, that can do nothing. It's thrown away. It's useless. It withers. It's gathered into a pile to be burned. Now, what we're talking about, connecting with him and consulting him so our path is straight, the best way, right? And he's saying here, if you're apart from me, if that's not happening, you can't do nothing. You're a branch that's withered and thrown away and burned. This is not kind language, is it? What does that look like? See, because I don't know any in this room, or anyone in my life for that matter, that was ever thrown into a pile and burned. I've never seen that. So maybe he means something else. Maybe he doesn't mean you're going to actually be thrown into a pile to be burned. So let me offer you this, and you can decide whether you agree with me or not, but let me just tell you what being thrown away and withered and apart from him you can do nothing might look like. Do you know that the divorce rate in this country is the same in the church as out of the church? It's about 50%. Let me give you some numbers. In 2012, 1.7 million people who once stood at the front of a church, etc., and vowed to love and cherish sickness and health forever. 1.7 million of them in 2012, they went from the stage to standing in front of a judge and said, I'm done. I don't care. I don't care who it hurts. I can't take the pain. I'm done. 1.7 million. You know what that didn't include? Minnesota, Louisiana, Indiana, Hawaii, Georgia, and then this one, California. So can we all agree, just maybe, that 1.7 million just jumped to 2 million real quick? See, I couldn't get those stats, and I couldn't find them. I dug and dug, couldn't find them for those states. But would you kind of agree with me that probably 2 million people stood before the judge and said, I'm done, I'm done. How about addiction? Do you know addiction relapses? In this country, they agree. If you look all over the internet, about 80% of people with addictions will relapse. That's death. Death for you, it's death for your family, it's death for your company, it's death for your church, it's death for everything that is around you. Do you know what recidivism is? Probably a couple people in here do. That's the term that the legal system uses for people that go back to jail. Do you know that statewide, all around the United States, that that rate is about 60 to 70% that they will go back to jail within 3 years? 60 to 70%. Moral failure, sexually immoral failure is rampant in our country. And it absolutely breaks my heart. I've only been in ministry, I've only been a Christian for 12 years, so I'm a very little guy and I'm a very little pond. But there's 7 billion people in this world. But just in my little world, as I was reviewing this and getting ready and thinking about just my own life with the people I know, and it crushes me to see the hurt and the pain and the failure of the people in our church that I love that have fallen victim to this stuff because they do not consult with the Lord. Amen. All the time, constantly. This is what it looks like. And you can argue with me till you're blue in the face, but I'm living this thing every single day with you guys. Less church attendance, where are they at? Less time in God's word. Giving becomes sporadic. Prayer falls off the table. Serving becomes a memory instead of a reality. And you go up to that person, and I'm telling you, it's every single one. There's a failure, and you're like, let me guess, you quit reading your Bible, huh? And every single one of them, I'm telling you, the head hits the chest. Yeah. I haven't seen you here in a couple weeks. Crashed finances. Oh, let me guess, you quit giving. I'm not saying Christianity is easy, but it's kind of simple. Consult with the Lord. Stay at it. I have never known a single person in my Christian life that was absolutely rocking it with Jesus. I'm talking just praying like crazy and serving like crazy and blessing people and praying like crazy that had this massive crash. I've never seen it. I will tell you this, I've seen people that are in high positions in ministry that have absolutely crashed, but go talk to them. It's because they got their eyes off of Christ. And they'll tell you, oh, I was busy working for Jesus, but I quit hanging out with him. Every stinking time. And I am so tired of seeing you guys hurting. There's nothing I can say other than don't do it anymore. Rock with Jesus 24/7. Stay at this thing. The Bible says if you seek me with your whole heart, you will find me. If you seek first the kingdom of God and my righteousness, all the things you need will be given to you. These are not the words of crashing failure. If you do not continually feed your soul with the nourishment that it needs, you will not flourish, you will fail. Every single time, there's no way around it. There's no way around it. Lean not on your own understanding, but seek God's will in everything you do, and He will direct your path. Don't you want Him to direct your path? You're going to be here maybe 80 years. We're all dumb. Who knows anything? Who's so brilliant that you would know the best thing to do in every situation of your life? Don't be looking at me because I got a microphone. Bust, crash, burn. Paul knew it. He wrote half the New Testament. Jesus got a way to talk to the Father. There's got to be something there. Why do we consult the Lord? The Bible tells us in Colossians 2:3 that it's in Christ lies all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Everything you need for life and life abundant is found in Christ, not in Siri. Not in Siri. We need to consult the Lord. Now, let's just put this out there. Let's just put out a big old fat chunk of honest. Who's in for honesty in church? Okay, all of us are in, right? Why don't we consult the Lord? Let me give you some reasons. See if you agree with me. Lazy. Right? That's a good one. Universal. Why does prayer fall off the table? Lazy. We're lazy. Here's another reason why prayer falls off the table. Because we're going to equate prayer and consulting the Lord. Would you agree? That's how we consult with the Lord. We talk to Him, right? So why else? Why else? He's as excited as Bibi. Look at that. Jesus. Yeah. Why else? Let me tell you why. Because you don't like it when He finally answers you, right? You, right? Remember our brother Theo? Remember what he said? He's going to tell you to do some crazy stuff, right? So we don't ask God, because if you don't ask, you don't hear. So we don't ask because we don't like what He's going to say to us. Or we don't think that what He tells us to do, we can pull it off. He tells you some crazy things. Joshua, I want you to go to the city, and I want you to tell everyone to walk around the city like a bunch of crazy people and six times, and then scream. How am I going to pull that one off? I just spit on you, sorry. You'll learn. First time visitor. So we don't like it because we don't like what He's going to tell us, and we don't feel like we can pull it off, right? We don't feel like we can pull it off. But again, I'm so happy that we have God's Word. So happy we have God's Word, because when I was reading that, it reminded me of a story. It reminds me of a story, and God speaks to this, Matthew 19. You go to Matthew 19, and you see there's a story from 16 to 26. Jesus is talking, and he's talking about a whole bunch of different things. But what he's basically saying, let me just paraphrase it for you. You can go there and read it. His disciples are hanging around Him, and they're like, well, what are we going to do to get saved? See, that's the mentality of people, right? Even today. Because they all answer, well, I do this so I'm good enough and I get in. That's the mentality across the board. What do I got to do? Like, there's something I can earn or do to get there. So Jesus is kind of confronting all this stuff. And He says, listen, it's virtually impossible for a wealthy man to get into the kingdom of God. It's easier for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle than for a wealthy man to get into the kingdom. Now, can a camel get through the eye of a needle? I mean, don't get all miracle-y on me. Just practical. No. Thank you. Okay, so you got an eye of a needle, it's about, you know, yay big, and you got a camel. So what is that telling you? It's impossible. It ain't happening. It's not going to happen. So what is He trying to tell us? He's trying to tell us that people of great resource, that's not the ticket. Leaning on my own understanding. You see, we're getting back here. Leaning on my own understanding. I don't need to consult the Lord. I can do something on my own. And He's like, no, you're powerless, wealthy man. You can't use your resources, no matter how much money you have, influence, power, prestige, position, doesn't matter. You can't get into the kingdom. Well, then who can get in, the disciples say. And he says, well, with humanly thinking, it's impossible. But with God, all things are possible. Yeah, that's a good amen spot. It's a good amen spot. So here's the thing. When God tells us to do something that we look at and go, man, that's impossible. Well, he said it. What are we supposed to do? This is what we do. It's right there on the screen. You pray to the God who could. Maybe. Perhaps. He might do it. He might deliver. I'm not quite sure. Let me give you some examples. Again, Bible. Nothing in my life. In 1 Samuel chapter 14, there's a young man named Jonathan. Do y'all remember who King David is? Right? King David, famous, most powerful, popular king in all of Israel, right? Before him was Saul. Saul's son was Jonathan. So Saul's fighting all these battles too. It's all in the Bible. That's all they do is fight over. They're crazy people. So they're fighting, right? So Jonathan, in 1 Samuel 14, he grabs his, let's just call it assistant soldier, his armor bearer. And he doesn't tell anyone, and he says, let's sneak down to the enemy camp. We're going to fight this army of people. So I want to offer you this. I want you to go to 1 Samuel chapter 14. I want you to see what he has to say. And when you talk about this, well, God who could? Blasphemy, Moses. What are you saying? Are you saying he can't? Well, listen to this. This is what Jonathan said in 14:6. Let's go across to the outpost of those pagans, Jonathan said to his armor bearer. Listen to this. This confidence. Perhaps the Lord will help us. Perhaps the Lord will help us. For nothing can hinder the Lord. He can win a battle whether he has many warriors or only a few. And the armor bearer, I love this guy. He says, do what you think is best, the armor bearer replied. I am with you completely, whatever you decide. But I love this guy. What is Jonathan? Who's Jonathan's God? The God who could. Perhaps, right? Perhaps we'll go down there and we'll get absolutely slaughtered and he won't deliver. But perhaps he will. Perhaps he will. How about another one? Daniel chapter 3. Anyone ever hear of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Three crazy names in the Bible, right? This is what's happened, that this nasty king of Babylon, Nebuchadnezzar, he's got a god complex. He wants everyone to bow to him. He has this big golden statue built, and he says everyone needs to bow to that. In other words, bow to me. And so these guys, these three dudes in Daniel chapter 3, this is what they say. You might throw me into this furnace. You remember the old Sunday school story, right? Who went to Sunday school, remember that, the fiery furnace, right? So Nebuchadnezzar's like, you either bow to me or I'm chucking you in this oven. That's what he said. So this is their answer, praying to the God who could. Daniel chapter 3, verse 17. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the oven, the God whom we serve is able to save us. He will rescue us from your power, your majesty. Now listen to this. But even if he doesn't, we want to make it perfectly clear to you, your majesty, that we will never serve your gods or worship the gold statue you've set up. See, he can deliver me, and perhaps he will. But even if he doesn't, they pray to the God who could. James chapter 5, verse 17 and 18, it says that Elijah, who's ever heard of Elijah? Great man of God, right? It says that Elijah was a man just like us. No different. And when he prayed earnestly that it wouldn't rain, God held off the rain for 3.5 years. And then he went and prayed again, and it rained. Audacious, crazy prayers to the God Who could, do you think that when he prayed, God, don't let it rain, do you think he absolutely, without a question of a doubt, knew that he could make the God of the universe do this? He could. How about 1 Kings chapter 18, 36 through 39? Here's the story again, same dude, Elijah. False prophets of Baal, this false god Baal. People are worshiping him. And here's Elijah over here going, he's the prophet of the real God. And all these people are around, tons, thousands and thousands of people. And they're up on top of Mount Carmel. And he's like, listen, why don't you crazy people over here, the worshipers of Baal, you build an altar over here. And let's put some animal on there and some wood on there. And then we'll go over here, the Jewish folks, we'll build an altar over here. We'll do the same thing. And then we're going to stand up right here. And you're going to call on your God. And I'm going to call on my God. And whoever God sends down a signal like fire from heaven, whoever sends that down, that's the God that's real. You guys in? Okay, let's do it. So they do it. Nothing. Nothing. Now look. Go to 1 Kings 18. You got to go there. 1 Kings 18. Verse 36, at the usual time for offering the evening sacrifice, Elijah the prophet walked up to this altar and he prayed this prayer in front of everybody. This is not in the closet praying, so if it fails, no shame. This is in front of everybody. He prayed, O Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, prove today that you are God in Israel and that I am your servant. Prove that I have done all of this at your command. O Lord, answer me. Answer me so these people will know that you are Lord, our God, and that you have brought them back to yourself. Immediately the fire of the Lord flashes down and burns up the sacrifice. Do you think he absolutely, like this is some historical precedence that if you call down fire from heaven from this God that it's going to happen? He's never seen this before, but he knew that God could. He knew that God could do this. Can I read you a, anyone ever read the book, The Circle Maker? I want to read you something. There's a man in ancient Jewish writings called Hani. There's a book from Mark Batterson, who's the pastor of National Community Church, and he wrote a book called The Circle Maker, and I recommend to each and every one of you that you buy it. And I want to read an excerpt from this book. We're talking about praying crazy, audacious prayers to a God. You're not insulting him when you ask him to do crazy things. What you're doing is you're telling him, I believe you are able. You and only you are able to do something that is absolutely impossible. You're giving value to him. This is what it says. I love this. This is a great book. There's a man named Hani, and he was living in Israel. And no one had heard from the Lord in 400 years. No prophecy. This is what happens. Young children danced in the downpour like it was the first rainfall they'd ever seen. And it was. Parents threw back their heads, opened their mouths, and caught raindrops like they were libations. And they were. When it hasn't rained in more than a year, raindrops are like diamonds falling from the sky. It would be forever remembered as the day. The day thunderclaps applauded the Almighty. The day puddle jumping became an act of praise. The day the legend of the circle maker was born. It was the second half of the first century BC, and a devastating drought threatened to destroy a generation, the generation before Jesus. The last of the Jewish prophets had died off nearly four centuries before. Miracles were such a distant memory that they seemed like a false memory. And God was nowhere to be heard. But there was one man, an eccentric sage, who lived outside the walls of Jerusalem, who dared to pray anyway. His name was Hani. And even if people could no longer hear God, he believed that God could still hear them. When rain is plentiful, it's an afterthought. During a drought, it's the only thought. And Hani was their only hope. Famous for his ability to pray for rain, It was on this day, the day, that Hani made his mark. With a 6-foot staff in his hand, Hani began to turn like a math compass. His circular movement was rhythmical and methodical. 90 degrees, 180 degrees, 270 degrees, 365 degrees, 360 degrees. He never looked up as the crowd looked on. After what seemed like hours but had only been seconds, Hani stood inside the circle he had drawn. Then he dropped to his knees, raised his hands to heaven. With the authority of the prophet Elijah, who called down fire from heaven, Hani called down rain. This is what he said. Lord of the universe, I swear before your great name that I will not move from this circle until you have shown mercy upon your children. The words sent a shudder down the spine of all who were within earshot that day. It wasn't just the volume of his voice, it was the authoritative tone. Not a hint of doubt, this prayer didn't originate in the vocal cords. Like water from an artesian well, the words flowed from the depth of his soul. His prayer was resolute yet humble, confident yet meek, expectant yet unassuming. And then it happened. As his prayer ascended to the heavens, raindrops descended to the earth. An audible gasp swept across the thousands of congregants who had encircled Hani. Every head turned heavenward as the first raindrops parachuted from the sky, but Hani's head remained bowed. The people rejoiced over each drop, but Hani was not. He was not satisfied with a sprinkle. Still kneeling within the circle, Hani lifted his voice over the sounds of celebration and said, "Not for such rain have I prayed, but for rain that will fill cisterns and pits and caverns." The sprinkle turned into such a torrential downpour that the consensus among eyewitnesses was that no raindrop was less than an egg in size. It rained so heavily and so steadily that the people fled to the Temple Mount to escape the flash floods. Hani stayed and prayed inside his protracted circle. Once more, he refined his bold request. "Not for such rain have I prayed, but for rain of benevolence, benediction, and grace." Then, like a well-proportioned sun shower on a hot and humid August afternoon, it began to rain in perfect moderation. Each raindrop was a tangible token of God's grace, and they didn't just soak the skin, they soaked the spirit with faith. It had been difficult to believe the day before the day. The day after the day, it was impossible not to believe. It's an awesome story. I'd like to offer you one other story, and it's in Joshua chapter 10. Joshua chapter 10 is a follow-up to Joshua chapter 9 in that the people of Gibeon deceived Joshua and his leaders into signing a peace treaty with them. Well, what happened was some of the other kings in the other cities were looking at this and going, "Hey, wait a minute now. They have signed a treaty with these people. And they're getting stronger. We need to go attack those people, the Gibeonites." So all these kings go attack. And so the Gibeon people said, "Listen, send a messenger to Joshua." No, not even close, guys. "Send a messenger to Joshua and tell him to come save us. We're your allies now. You have to protect us, big mighty Joshua and big mighty Israel. So go help us." So the scriptures say that Joshua went all night with his army, and when dawn came, they began to fight. They began to fight. Now, today is a little different than back then. See, today if I'm in the armed services, I can go to a computer screen somewhere in Washington and I can put in some coordinates. I can press a button. And I can send a missile from my silo into your toilet. No problem. Any day, any time. Well, see, it wasn't like that back then. See, what happened back then is they would march, and when the sun came up, you guys would go out, and we would fight hand to hand. And you know who would win? The person who's alive. When the rest of these guys are dead, you win. Or if these people retreat, you win. See, they didn't have infrared technology and computers and radar and all that stuff. Sun comes up, they fight to the death, and that's who wins. So look what happens in Joshua chapter 10. Verse 12, on the day the Lord gave the Israelites victory over the Amorites, this is insane. Joshua prayed to the Lord in front of all the people of Israel. 2 million people. He stood up before these people and he said, "Sun, stand still. We need light, God. We need to finish this battle, God. We need to wipe them out like you said, God, and we need you to hold the sun still." And guess what? It did. We know the earth turns, right? God made the earth stop turning, so the sun didn't set. It says that it went a whole day and didn't set. Now listen to this. This is crazy. It says here, the sun stood still and the moon stayed in place until the nation of Israel had defeated its enemies. Verse 14, there has never been a day like this one before or since when the Lord answered such a prayer. Now think about that. Joshua has no historical evidence, no proof that this would ever happen. But he stood up in front of 2 million people and said, "In Jesus' name, sun, stand still," and it did. He had no proof. He was praying, what, to the God who could. He might not, and it says it's never happened since. You think other people have said that? "I need to fix my car. The sun's going down. Lord, let the sun stand still." We've all prayed it, right? Has it happened? No. It's never happened since. But listen, when you pray, you have to pray to the God who could. He might stop the sun for you because he can. That's the kind of God that he is. That's the kind of God that he is. He could deliver Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego from the fiery furnace. Maybe. He could deliver the rain to the people of Israel on Hani's request. He could. He could deliver Jonathan and his armor bearer and win the battle. He might. He might respond to Elijah's prayer and make rain or call down fire from heaven. He could. But guess what? He could for you too. He could for you. And I think that one of the things that this church needs to understand, this group of people needs to understand, is that he could for you. This defeated attitude in this church too much. He could stop the sun for you. You're no different than Elijah. No different. He could stop the sun for you. How many people in here would love to be debt free? You might. You could ask him to help you and he might do that for you. How many people in here would love to have a spouse that loves them, that could serve the Lord next to them? And you've waited and waited, or you need your spouse to come back home because he's a stinking wreck or she's a wreck, and you need that to happen. You think it's too far. Pray to the God who could. He might send them home. You never know. You never know. How many people need a physical healing? A physical healing. Listen, the Bible talks about this lady who was bleeding for her whole life, and she went to every single doctor. I did the logical thing. I made the pros and cons. I went to go to the doctor, and nothing worked. But if I could just get to the robe of Jesus, I could be healed, and she was. How many people need that? So pray to how many people prayed for healing and it hasn't happened? He's the God who could, but you have to believe that he can do it. You have to believe it. How many people need a new career, but you feel so stuck in your job and you absolutely freaking hate it, and you want a new job and you never get one and nothing works? Pray to the God who could give you a new career. He could make it happen today. How many people would love a child There's so many people in this world that would love a child. There's some of us that have a million kids, and there's some of us that want one, and they can't have one, and they've tried, and they've tried, and they've tried, and nothing, and they've gone to doctors and artificial insemination, and nothing works. I want to introduce you to a lady. Her name is Hannah. She's in 1 Samuel year after year after year. No child, no child, no child. And she begged the Lord, please give me a son. Guess what she got? A son. She got a son. How many people would like to start a new business of their own and they don't have the resources? Pray to the God who can. How many people would like to be delivered from addiction? If the Bible says that if you're in Christ, you're a new creation, the old man is dead. Behold, the new man, that the Spirit of the living God who raised Christ from the dead lives in you. You want to be part of the 80% that relapses, or do you want to be part of the 20% that doesn't? Or maybe we could push back darkness and it's 25% that doesn't, or 30% that doesn't, because the church finally believes that the Spirit that raised Christ from the dead lives inside of you and you can do all things through Christ. When are you going to learn that? That's what we need to do. We need to pray to the God who can bust the addiction once and for all. You have that sin has no power over you anymore. You can throw the cigarette down and stomp it out. You can put the freaking drink down and stop pouring battery acid into your life. You don't need to do it. You don't need to do it. How many people have been called into ministry? I know I should be in serving the Lord full time. I know that's what he wants me to do, but I'm afraid because I won't be provided for. Seek first the kingdom of God. What's my purpose? I'm afraid to jump into ministry because I don't know what you want me to do, Lord. Chicken. You know what your purpose is? It's wrapped up in two words. Colossians 1:16 says everything was made by him and for him. That's what you were made for. That's your purpose. Your purpose is to worship him. And if you will seek him with your whole heart and go full tilt boogie after Jesus, your purpose, your mission, what you're supposed to do specifically, it's going to show up on your doorstep and you can't deny it. And if you think you were supposed to be called to ministry but you're afraid, you don't know what to do, pray. Consult the Lord. Ask him what to do. Maybe you have a special longing in your heart for certain people groups somewhere in this world. And you just feel that tug all the time, all the time. I'm supposed to go share the gospel with these people. And I just can't seem to get the money up and the courage up. And I have to work and I get the kids and I never and make an excuse after excuse. But I want to go. I want to go. Pray to the God who could. Maybe you'll be funded by some mysterious thing that just shows up. Who's had those? Come on, right? Crazy. Pray to the God who could. How about the one who's, get over here, Eric. How about the one who's been in and out of jail, addicted to drugs and drinking and sticking his arm so full of needles that he should have been dead. But there was a mommy for years, this lady here, who prayed for him because he's the God who could save him. And he saved. Right? Was there a guarantee that Eric was going to be saved? No, but she believed in a God who could do it. She believed in a God who could move mountains to get to Eric, and he did. He did, and we have to believe. James 4:2 simply says this, you don't have what you want because you don't ask God for it. That's your word. You got to pray to the God who could. You got to pray crazy, massive, out of this world, impossible prayers. You know why? Who in their wildest imagination, without the Bible, without looking back in history, could ever think that there could be some spirit that would go planet, and there it was. That's the God you're praying to. So stop putting a lid on Almighty and start to begin praying crazy, powerful prayers that no one would think in your right mind you should pray. And do it publicly. Give him an opportunity to shine. Put him up on a silver platter for the whole world to see. Do something. Ask him for something crazy, just like Joshua, in front of everybody. Lord, let the sun stand still. Put yourself out there. Risk it all. Risk your reputation. Who cares what anybody thinks? Give God an opportunity to shine in your city. Do something crazy. That's what we need to start doing. In Joshua 8, it says that they were going to ambush this town. This is part of praying crazy prayers. They were going to ambush this town, so this is what they're going to do. We're going to send half the army up here, right up the gut, put the other half behind the city, and when we run up the gut, those people in the city are going to come after us, and we're going to turn and run away. And as soon as they run away, you jump up and chase after them, and then we'll turn around and go back into them. We sandwich them, we crush them. Good plan, but here's what I want you to see. He said, I want you to wait in ambush. Wait for the ambush. And some of us are waiting on the Lord's signal and waiting and waiting and waiting and waiting. Pull the trigger. Pull the trigger. It says that they were to wait in ambush, but comma, but be ready to act. That's what it said. On my signal, when God says, Joshua, now, and Joshua picks up the spear, be ready to act. So when God says to go do something, reckless abandon, begin to pray for it and act. Don't be shy. Pull the trigger. Start asking crazy things from this crazy, powerful God. Do it. Start doing some stuff that's crazy. You know what I do? This is what I do. I want to spend some time. I want to pray with you. But I want to tell you what I do. I'm so crazy that even though there's, you know, 50 or 60 people here, small church in the scheme of things, right? I go down the road and I call real estate office, real estate signs for buildings that are 50 and 60 and 80,000 square feet, and I ask them if they'd be willing to give them to us. Because I think that God could do that. I think that he could. I don't know about you guys, I don't know where you're at with your walk, I don't know where you are in ministry, I don't know how excited you are about Jesus and his church and all that stuff, but I'm just going to tell you right now, the cat's out of the bag. In my lifetime, I want to see thousands and thousands, can you see it? I want to see thousands of people repenting of sin and rushing to the altar and grabbing a hold of Jesus and worshiping. I want to see thousands of people come to Christ through this church. Thousands of them. I want to send the message of the gospel, not just to the Golden Triangle, not just to Lake County. I want to send it to the ends of the earth. That's the kind of vision that I have for this church. That's what I want to see. And so I ask for things that are crazy. I'm asking God to let us be the catalyst to see thousands. Amen, sister. See, she gets it. Thousands of people come to Christ. That's what I want to see. Are you asking him for that? Are you asking him that next week there'd be 500 people here, that people would get saved, that we'd be putting people in the tank, they'd be giving their life to Christ? Do you ask God for that? Because he's the God who can. He's the God who can, and you don't know unless you ask. So we need to pray crazy, audacious prayers. And it's not an insult. When you do it, you're giving God the authority he deserves. He's the one who could do crazy things beyond any of our resources, and we need to pray just like that. Do you pray for your president? Do you believe with all your heart, honestly, that God Almighty, the creator of heaven and earth, can invade any person in Washington and turn his heart to Christ right now? Do you believe that he could do it? Do you pray that way? Do you know that there are thousands and thousands of Muslims coming to Christ? You know how? Through dreams. Jesus is invading their lives through dreams. He is making himself seen in their heads at night while they're sleeping, and they're coming to Christ by the thousands. Are you praying for these people? Are you praying that there be a change, that the leaders of the radical Islam world would find Christ and Christ would find them and they would be saved? You pray that way. Do you believe that God could do that? Come on, do you believe God could do that? He saved me. He saved you. He saved us. If he could save you, can't he save the worst? He saved Paul. Paul was killing Christians, and he wrote half the New Testament and planted churches, and his words right now are the words of life that God has put in his mouth and into your heart. And God saved that man to change the world. Do you pray that way for this church? That God would use this church for that? Those are the prayers we have to pray. We have to pray huge, crazy prayers that only God can do. And do not put a limit on him. Do not put a limit on him. So I want to invite you right now. I'm going to ask the men to come up. I don't even know where communion is, if we even have it. There it is over there. Two men, anyone, doesn't matter. Come up, we're going to pass that out. But while you're holding on to that, this is what I want you to do. Don't blow it off. Don't blow this off. Take this moment, whatever it is, 2 or 3 minutes before we come back and take communion together. But take a few minutes to take that crazy prayer that you've been thinking about, that you'd love to see God do, but you never thought it possible. The Eric in your life, the one who was so gone, the John's parents, who had to deal with that train wreck. Dan, who was the raging lush, never to be found, right? He's found. Jesus found him. Come on. He found him. Like, it's not, no one's beyond the reach of God. No one, his ear is not too deaf to hear you. His arm is not too short to grab you. We want you to pray. So whatever it is, whether it's debt that's killing you, whether it's addiction that's got you, that owns you, stop managing your addiction. You know what? If you are, it's managing you. You need a delivery. You need to be, that sin needs to be broken in your life. Ask God to take that desire for drugs and alcohol and sex and porn and shopping and eating and whatever thing that owns you, ask him to take it away and put it at the foot of the cross. Ask him to do something crazy. Ask him to use this church to reach the nations across the earth. Pray for people. Pray for your government. The one who's in charge here is not the guy you want elected. Jesus is the king, and he's the solution, and his gospel is the solution to every problem to mankind. Pray to that one who can deliver. He is the God who could. Pray, pray, pray. Don't hold back. Take a few minutes to pray, and then we'll come back. We'll take communion together as a family.